What a scene. I've just come to use the toilet, really.
I can't believe that.
Yes. TV cop.
You knew that.
Now, actor Kevin Woodford. This is your life.
For the first time in my life, I'm speechless. Well, totally speechless.
I'm sure you'll catch up. Well, already baking nicely under our lights, a selection of family and friends and a cassoulet of cooks, and the pièce de résistance, your wife Jean, with your children Janine and Stephen. Jean, when you met Kevin, it was a case of upstairs, downstairs.
Yes, we met as teenagers when I was working at the Fort Anne Hotel in Douglas, Isle of Man, and Kevin was as well. And he was working downstairs in the kitchens, and I was working upstairs in the housekeeping department. When we first met, he got his first kiss because he offered to bake me a birthday cake. After we had our first kiss, that was it. And then some time later, when he wanted to propose, he said, if I give you a slice of gâteau, will you marry me? And I said, yeah.
Simple enough.
Yeah. We'll stop before we get to the meringue.
Kiss was great. The kiss was great. The cake was horrible, wasn't it?
No, it must have been an exceedingly good cake, because you marry at St Ninian's Church in Douglas on November the 8th, 1969. You've been wooing fans with your cooking and smooth talk ever since. But it's not all slicing, dicing and icing.
Here we go.
Sweet, sweet. You taste it.
Oh, yeah. Delicious.
This is my my first day out.
This is your first day?
Yeah.
This is a sultana and lemon turd. No. Taste it.
Like, you're so showbiz, you chef.
Rock and roll, Kevin Oldson.
And the other thing that's new is me.
Voila, the dish is complete.
Now, Kevin, you've never been afraid to try something new in your career. Today was your first taste of acting, a cameo role in the series Doctors, with a diagnosis of your prospects, regulars at the Lethbridge practice.
Congratulations, Kevin.
Kevin, hi. It's a pleasure to have you on Doctors, your debut, and in years to come they will be saying that esteemed actor, Sir Kevin Woodford, where were you when he started? And we can say you were right here. Fantastic. I know how you're feeling, but that's what happens when you receive the red book. Trust me, I'm a doctor. Lots of luck. Have a lovely evening. And thanks for choosing Doctors. Take care, Kev.
Good luck.
Bye.
You probably needed all kinds of attention after a report you did for the holiday programme that could have been a scene from Fasten Your Seatbelt.
It don't matter, Mr. Man.
Other side! Left!
Turn right, go right, go right!
Come on, baby, I've done it, I've done it.
That's first.
I'm ready for a cup of tea.
I can murder a pint.
She's on your side of the road tonight from driving school, Maureen Rees.
I got a twist. I stand still now, stand still. I have to tell you, right, that I have still got... Have a look there, because I have still got...
You're still taking the tablets.
I am. But I've still got a lump on my head from where Maureen changed at 70 miles an hour from third gear into first gear. And my head rocketed forward and it hit the... Do you remember that, darling? Yeah.
Maureen, amazed and happy to see you in one piece. What was that actually all about?
Well, they wanted a madcap driver for to show Kevin round Spain, so they thought of me. And believe you me, I give Kevin a run for his money. He didn't get a suntan, but he stayed white.
But he still loves you, I think.
Aww.
Oh, she's a star.
Maureen, thank you very much. Now let's go to the card. Kevin Alexander Woodford, this is your life. You were born on June the 4th, 1950.
Excuse me?
You were born in the appropriately named Jane Cookall Maternity Home in Douglas on the Isle of Man. You're adopted and raised by your grandparents, Arthur and Beryl Woodford, sadly no longer with us. They looked after you well, didn't they?
They were absolutely... They were gems. I mean, they anything that I wanted to do, they gave me guidance, love and support, and they were wonderful.
Well, your uncle Eddie, to you, of course, a brother, emigrated to Canada, joined the Air Force there and later the Diplomatic Corps. He has a few well-chosen words to offer now from his home in Ottawa. Eddie Woodford.
Hello, Kevin, and greetings from Canada. So Michael got his man. I guess he could come here and join our mounted police. I'm so thrilled you're being honored tonight, and by speaking to you like this, at least I know I can say a few things without being interrupted. Although I'm based here, you know I'm always thinking of you, and I'm very proud of you and all of the things that you have achieved. But you know, if you had not made the grade as a chef or on TV, I think I could have had a word in high places and fixed you up as a lumberjack. It's just cutting and chopping on a bigger scale. I hope you're finding time to work on your golf game, and I look forward to our next meeting. Have a great night, Kevin. All the very best.
You go to Murray's Road Primary School and on to St Ninian's and Douglas High School. Now, you've always been proud of your Manx roots, and the folk there are proud of you too, as we'll hear now on a trip round the island with the Isle of Man's Chief Minister, Don Gelling, accompanied by a famous resident.
Hi, Kevin. Greetings from the Isle of Man. I'm sorry this report isn't up to your usual standards, but then the crew aren't up to scratch.
Oh, Kevin!
We're really delighted you're being honoured tonight, Kevin, because the way you represent the Isle of Man and support the charitable causes is fantastic. The Isle of Man Post Office are soon to launch a new commemorative stamp, Tastes of the Isle of Man. It's in your honour, Kevin. I only hope they'll be able to get the glue tasting as good as some of your recipes. Your success is a far cry from your days as a student here at St Ninian's High School. In fact, it's just opposite St Ninian's Church where you got married. But even then you were keen to do well. Remember your holiday jobs. One was to lead the donkeys along the beach. Of course, the donkeys have long since retired to this lovely sanctuary. It's a shame I can't say the same for my helper.
No, start again.
Hi, Kevin. Everything all right?
Another of your jobs was as a butcher's boy, delivering meat around the town on a push bike for Morehouse's, the butcher's. That's not a butcher's bike.
It's the best I could do anyway.
Well done, Kevin. Have a great night. See you when you come home.
Hey, congratulations, Kevin. I know you've got the best restaurant in town. It's the only time I've ever had a fried egg with a shell on. Cheers, mate. All the best. Bye-bye.
And that, of course, was Chief Minister Don Gelling and the Isle of Man's court jester, Sir Norman Wisdom. Now, long before your cooking career, you've been inclined to agree with Shakespeare about music being the food of love. You'd been a choir boy, but when the swinging 60s reached the island, you're keen to become lead singer in a band. You team up with school pals and you call yourselves the Fortune Tellers. I predict another surprise.
Because, Woody, I think it's time for a band reunion.
Nearly 40 years on, Fortune Tellers Dave McLean, Dougie Kinley and Eddie Killen. Very good. Dave, tell us about the glory days.
I don't think it was glory days so much. We started out really as a lark, didn't we, when we were at school? But we finally found out people pay money to come and see us, so
good money.
Why not?
But Dougie, the group changed name and direction.
Yeah, it did. We were doing okay, but then they had a seaman's strike, and I think we had a bright idea that we'd call ourselves The Strike, so everybody would talk about us, and they did. And then we went on, we played beneath the Rolling Stones and The Who, way down the bottom. But
we did, but we used to be on before The Who,
yes,
didn't we? In this place where there'd be about 2,000 screaming youngsters, and we'd be on about an hour before The Who come on. And it was fantastic because we'd be banging out our stuff and all you could hear is, get off, rubbish! We played on, didn't we?
We did.
Eddie, any sign then of Kevin the Cook?
Absolutely, because when he was 14, he cooked a really mean spaghetti bolognese. And I mean, all of us have fantastic memories, Kevin. And I'd just like to jog it once more with a little token off the pass. Which you can have those.
Well, thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, gents.
It's nice to see you.
All the best.
Thank you very much.
It was at around that time that it occurred to you that you might look tasty in chef's gear. You've often said your role model was a celebrated TV cook. You watched the master in action at that much-loved Midlands motel, Crossroads.
Oh, Glenda, yeah. Go and get the strawberry mousses, lay them out in a tray, and I'll do it up with topping, right?
No! Oh, now what's happened?
I hate to think, Agnes!
You've never met your hero until tonight. He is here, the laddie with the ladle, Shuey McPhee, alias actor Angus Lennie. Angus, how does it feel to be responsible for Kevin Woodford?
Well, it's a bit of a responsibility. Of course, Kevin, you've always said that Shuey McPhee was your inspiration. Well, I mean, I can't boil an egg.
Well, someone said I can't.
But seriously, Kevin, you've always paid me a lovely compliment every time you've mentioned Shuey McPhee. And most of all, you've not only mentioned Shuey McPhee, but you've remembered Angus Lennie.
Of course I have.
God bless.
Thank you very much indeed, Angus. Delighted to meet you.
Angus was in The Great Escape, you know.
I do know that. It's in all seriousness, there was something about that guy in that television programme that inspired me as a young 14-year-old with a satchel full of homework, and I would sooner sit and watch that programme. And it was at that point then I thought, well, that's where I want to go. And it was the hat, Angus. That's what it was. It was purely the hat.
Well, it didn't do me too bad either.
Good.
So at last you had a bona fide career plan. You wanted to be a chef. And on you go to Douglas College of Catering, and you complete the 3-year course in just 2. You help to pay your way with holiday jobs in the kitchens of local hotels. You meet Jean, and she's impressed. And soon after you get together, you meet Jean's sister, Wendy, who's also taking a holiday on the island. And Wendy, Kevin was soon counting on your support.
Yeah, in many ways. Kevin was always a bit of a daredevil, and he used to drive the hotel stock car. And we often used to go to the races and cheer him on. On this particular occasion, we went on to see him, and he dashed off and asked me for my tights. And I had to whip the tights off quick because the fan belt had gone on the car. Well, he went on and he won the race, I'm glad to say, but he still owes me that pair of tights, actually.
In 1970, the year after you and Jean were married, Stephen is born, followed 8 years later by Janine. And your career builds. Your CV soon boasts the names of top hotels like the Dorchester and the Georges V in Paris. There's a lot to learn in your game, and you're always keen to educate junior staff. In 1973, you go one step further and you become a lecturer, first at the North Lindsay College in Scunthorpe. Did you take to the life?
I did. I loved it. If you have a skill and you can impart a little bit of knowledge to somebody who's thirsty for that knowledge, I don't think there's anything nicer than that.
Stephen, in Scunthorpe, you added a personal touch to one of your father's creations.
That's right. Dad had just laid a concrete floor in the hallway in Scunthorpe, and he'd spent days and days making sure it was perfectly level. And he told me as a young, relatively naughty 4-year-old boy to stay upstairs while it dried. So, of course, I go to the top of the stairs, take my wellies off and throw them down the stairs and bury them in his new concrete floor.
I remember it.
More lecturing jobs follow in Nottingham and Scarborough. You gain a higher degree in management at Hull University. And then in 1983, you apply to be head of the prestigious hotel and catering department of Granville College in Sheffield.
And I was delighted, Kevin, when you got the job, even though it was ahead of me.
He was your principal lecturer at Sheffield, Ian Greer. So, Ian, you were both in running for the top job.
Yes, we were, and I was delighted Kevin got it. I'd known him for a couple of years before that, and we had a good few years, didn't we, Kevin? We jointly managed the department.
Yeah.
We set up the chef's diploma course.
Yep.
You remember we took the students to Clermont-Ferrand?
I do.
And the mayor was Giscard d'Estaing,
that's
who
right.
was the former premier
President,
of France.
That's right.
And we cooked the socks off them.
We did.
So good,
yeah.
They brought us back the next year, didn't they, to
yeah.
do it again?
Yeah.
International fame. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Martin.
Fantastic to see you.
Your aim at Sheffield was to turn out students with passion, hungry to gain experience. And the hope was that some would bring their expertise back to the city. Making your dream a reality are Carey Brown and Christian Kent. So, Christian, you owe it all to Kevin.
I do indeed. 3 years under Kevin's wing. It was very firm, very fair. And he sent me down to London 13 years ago, and I've just moved back and opened a 130-seat brasserie, which is fully booked tonight. thank you very much.
Thank you for coming.
You.
And Carey?
I've just opened my restaurant number 2 in Sheffield, where Kevin taught me at Granville College, took me under his wing, and showed me his love, his passion and enthusiasm, and scared me to death. but I've got it to thank for him. He got my first head chef's job as well in Sheffield, and look back. Thank you very much. Cheers.
Lads like that are just the epitome of what the game is all about. And, you know, congratulations, lads. I'm delighted that you've made it.
Thank you.
Well, your own reputation grows and you're invited to present a cookery slot on BBC Radio Sheffield with DJ Tony Capstick. So, Tony, a celebrity chef was born.
Well, in a way. It was very popular. He'd either come to the studio or I'd go down to the college and he'd talk us through a recipe and a presentation, but we had a laugh as well.
What he's not saying is that the very first broadcast we did together, I turned up to the studio and we decided that we'd do a fish dish. I said, oh, look at this lovely fresh mackerel, and Tony cottoned on straight away. He said, oh, it's lovely, look at those bulging eyes. There was nothing there. And I said, right, what we'll do is let's put a bit of butter in the pan. So I went, shh. So we did this whole sort of 20 minute of audio cookery.
The magic
that you
of radio.
When you go back.
Fabulous.
The magic of radio indeed.
Indeed.
Nice to see you, Tony.
You're a hit with listeners, and soon you do the same for viewers. Producers like your style. You pop up on a number of shows, and then you get the call from BBC Television to help celebrities who aren't too hot in the kitchen department to find their way through foolproof recipes. Your pupils were all reluctant cooks.
Can That's I show it, you? Then?
Yep.
Yeah.
Now, I bet you haven't got one of those yuppie garlic presses, have you?
What, no. Do you mean there's oh, no.
You know what I mean, where you press it like that, and all the garlic comes all over the
place. Everywhere.
Except under the bit of supposed you're 9 hours washing
no.
out.
On the receiving end of your helping hand there, Sue Pollard.
You were so good, but I tell you what, I always remember your jaw dropped, right, at the state of my utensils.
Yes.
Please, madam! Do you remember? I had one pot, one pan.
Yes, I remember.
Right, one blunt knife.
No, stop before you get the knife, because the pan, the pan, right, you didn't know where the pan was. I had to find the pan, which I did find the pan in the cupboard, and the pan on the bottom, on the inside, had the price, £3.17.
Oh, don't. Chapel Market is special. But I think that programme did me a favour because the viewers felt so sorry for me. I got sent 6 garlic presses and 3 sets of sharpen your own knives.
Oh, no.
Lovely to see you. Lots of love to you.
Thank you.
apologies to you. The 1980s and 90s are a boom time for TV cooks, and you are there for the ride. As well as helping reluctant cooks, you're a surprise chef and the flying cook and microwave maestro for Richard and Judy. And Jean, that meant there was a lot of fast food at your home.
Yes, microwaves were not his chosen form of cookery. We didn't possess a microwave. And so for this, Kevin had to test new recipes, and he acquired three microwaves, and all around the house every day, all we could hear is ping, ping, ping while he tested this recipe.
Add a few lyrics and you've got a hit, I suppose. In 1994, Cooking Against the Clock gets a new twist when you record the pilot for yet another food show. It's called Ready, Steady, Cook. It's a hit, and several guest cooks become household names. Among them is Leslie Waters. Leslie, Kevin was up to the challenge.
He's always been up to the challenge, and I mean, and it's a really challenging show, creating stuff out of those bags. But you always do a brilliant job, and you're never lost for a word or two, except I can remember a time once when Fiona Phillips came on the show.
And we can see now how Kevin rose to the occasion.
So I went shopping.
I'm off.
No.
Kevin, what did you do with 11 potatoes?
I thought I'd make a gnocchi out of it. That'd be brilliant, right? So I grabbed a knife and I was frantic. Do you remember this, Leslie? I was whacking my way through the potatoes, and I took a really, really deep cut under the thumb. But you know, you keep going, ready, steady, cook. The director had noticed that I'd cut myself, moved cameras over to Les, and I got my hand down on the floor, and a nurse had crawled under the bench, and so I've now got a nurse between my legs pulling a plaster on, so I've lost about 4 minutes. It was the biggest nightmare I've ever had on Ready, Steady, Cook.
In 1995, you take on the job of salvaging kitchen disasters again in the award-winning Can't Cook, Won't Cook. The greatest challenge for TV producers must have been to think up new names. One of the contestants in Can't Cook turned out to have a very familiar name.
Let's see if they can guess. A bit of a connection here. Can you guess?
No.
You don't have to if you don't want to.
Tell us what the connection is.
I believe she's actually your daughter.
She's my daughter.
Janine, that was you proving that cooking doesn't run in the family.
I think it's fair to say that I was a terrible chef in those days, but you've given me some lessons and I think I've improved, but I think it's fair to say that I won't be following your footsteps.
She's actually very good now, but that particular point, the reason they put her on was because she asked us once that she wanted to cook for a friend, and she'd bought a ready-made pizza, some salad leaves, dead easy, and we went out, didn't we, for dinner? And when we came back, we said, how was it? She said, it was dreadful, awful. And so I said, how can it be awful? You'd put it under the grill. It's as simple as that. She said, it was fine till I turned it over to cook the other side.
Well, like all good chefs, you bless the nation with a raft of cookbooks, but every menu needs changing now and then, and you're soon branching out from cooking shows to go on assignment for holiday and fasten your seatbelt. And there's a complete change of pace when you become as much a part of Sundays as the family roast. You're a regular on Songs of Praise and present the Heaven and Earth Show.
And we wear Kevin's Angels.
Come on down, Esther McVeigh and Toya Wilcox. Esther first.
My everlasting sort of memory has to be something we codenamed Operation Makeup, because people see at 9, 10 o'clock of a Sunday morning, smiley happy people with smiley happy faces, but at 5:45 of a Sunday morning, it's quite the opposite, isn't it? It's sort of hair one way, face the other, lines from makeup, and us saying to Julia, do something, and she's shouting back, I'm a makeup artist, not a plastic surgeon, we're saying do anything anyway. So mascara, there's mousse, there's makeup, lipstick, and that's just what you have. and then, true. What's it? It's an intravenous caffeine, and it's 3, 2, 1, and we're smiling. But I'm glad you're still smiling.
Fantastic.
Toya.
Well, he always was smiling that time in the morning, but we both decided that we'd walk to the studio at 7 a.m. every morning, Sunday morning, and Kevin always had a box of chocolates, and he left it in this bus shelter, which I never quite understood why, and I plucked up the courage to ask him. And he left this box of chocolates for a homeless woman who kept her bags in the bus shelter. But we never knew if she got it, because she was never quite there, but her bags were there. But I always remember that you were insistent that this box of chocolates was left there.
Lovely story. Thank you. Now, one of the most enjoyable experiences of your fan-packed life was when producer Andrew Fettis teamed you with an American counterpart for the series Big Kevin, Little Kevin. Now, we always aim for a big finish, and they don't come much bigger than this. 6'9" and 28 stone at the last count, flown in from his home in New Orleans, Kevin Belton. Oh. You've very soon got the measure of our Kevin.
You know, I always had a great interest in Great Britain. But this man showed me the love for Great Britain and the UK. And not only is he a chef, but he's a great husband, a great father. And I'm around because I'm a big guy to carry his heart, because he's got a big heart. And nobody's got a bigger heart than he does.
Thank you. Thank you. And Kevin Woodford.
This Is Your Life, back on Thursday next week at 8:30. Tonight on BBC One, Animal Hospital follows the National Lottery draw. Next.